and gentlemen, two great songwriters and two great friends of Ed Kleban, David Shire and Richard Maltby.
He didn't have to come out to Los Angeles to write it. We all know, all of us who knew Ed know that he was as thorough in his attention to details about his lyrics and music as he was about his life. And because Richard and I and Ed shared the same lawyer, Alan Stein, we happened to find out that he put a codicil in his will in his last few months, which stated that under no circumstances would Marvin Hamlisch be allowed to sing What I Did for Love at my memorial. True. It's always troubled me that because of the enormous success of Chorus Line and Ed's so untimely death, his reputation for the world at large is as a world-class lyricist and not as the brilliant composer he was. We all know he wrote tons of songs both before Chorus Line, and unfortunately we never got to hear it. The songs he would have written way after Chorus Line. If, for instance, Steve Sondheim had written West Side Story, the lyrics to West Side Story and to Gypsy, and his career ended there, he would have been deprived of some tremendous music that followed. When Ed passed away, he left me his piano. I was very touched by that, but I already had three pianos. And I played that piano many times in order to audition songs for Ed and get his input, which was always very honest, very critical, very valuable. So I didn't want to put that piano in storage. So I made it on a semi-permanent loan to Jim Friedman, who produced Baby and Closer Than Ever. And I knew would really appreciate the specialness of that instrument. But I had one last chance to play it before I sent it to him. And I can tell you that I felt so many songs in that piano that we have been deprived of. But you can imagine how great they would have been.
This evening can honor Ed, the composer, as well as the lyricist. I'm here. Actually, I have another position in the world. I'm the president of the Kleban Foundation, which is Ed set up a foundation that was so unbelievably smart. He knew that composers always could work, and that nobody wants to hire a lyricist or a book writer. And so he set up a foundation that was going to give an award every year to a promising lyricist and composer. He did that in 1990, and since then we have given that award to more than 50 writers. It's sizable. He was going to give a percentage of the income from a Chorus Line. He had no idea how much was actually going to add up to. The award currently is $100,000 a year to each one, $100,000 to each winner in two $50,000 segments. It's absolutely stunning, and I can tell you the number of people who have won it and said, "Oh my God, this has just come at the right time. I was going to give up and go back to Duluth. And it has saved. Although I must say, one person did say, $100,000? God, now I can give up trying to be a writer. And she did. So, anyway, it's a gesture of such enormity. The theater will benefit forever from this moment and from this decision of his. The number of shows already, Tony winners, Dramatist winners, Off-Broadway winners, and for God's sakes, the number of significant shows that aren't prize winners but are absolutely wonderful, that owe their existence to this start. And I'll tell you, there's one other thing about it. It's the only award I know that is not given for something that someone has done. This is an award given on the promise of something that the writer will do. And that is breathtaking to me. Every year we give the award, and it is heartwarming. I now get to introduce our next song, which is a song from Gallery, which was a show I was directing, and Art Edwards writing a bunch of songs based upon, they were like glosses on famous paintings, and they formed a show that had a real substance to it. So I'm going to say, let us welcome back John Michael Lyons, at Lyles, and from the cast of Fiddler on the Roof, Julie Benko.
David, why? love.